even when someone cuts you off. Even if you lost $1 million in the stock market today. Nothing really seems capable of getting you that upset.
Hey crew, I've got the key to that 23 Rolls Royce Phantom. We are gonna take it for a drive, but first let's check it out what looks on the inside and outside. The Phantom gets a refresh for the 23 model year, so we'll kind of just focus on the things that are new, including this horizontal chrome bar above the Pantheon grille that now is illuminated. The Spirit of Ecstasy gets a mild rework, and she's now illuminated from the bottom. The BMW LED laser headlights adorn this Rolls-Royce, and they've got LED DRLs and turn signals. But Rolls-Royce adds this starlight design to the border of the headlight to mirror the starlight headliner inside the vehicle. This one is painted in Iguazu blue metallic, and in some light it looks blue, and in other light it looks purple. It adds a flat black hood and this Pelony pink coach line that goes down the side. For 23, there are new wheel designs, including this part polished 22-inch design wrapped in Continental all-season tires, 255 section front and 285 at the rear. Stepping back to look at the profile, the Phantom is just under 19 feet long and it's 5 feet 4 inches tall, meaning this sedan is about as tall as some of the small SUVs that are entering the market. It just commands your attention. And here at the back, there aren't really any changes. We've got the LED taillights and turn signals. And then this one has chrome finished exhaust ports for the four individual pipes. And though this Phantom right here is not my perfect spec, for me, that would be a dark green one with the 1920s style dish wheels. It's still an incredible statement. What do you guys think though? Is this better or worse looking than a Mercedes Maybach S-Class? Let me know in the comments and let's check out the interior. Opening up from the passenger side, because if you're gonna be driven around in a Phantom, it's gotta be on this side, and pulling gently on the coach doors, which open from the center, bidding you access to two tones of sumptuous leather. It's covering the entirety of this door panel. We've got grace white, we have black, and then there's a Pelony pink contrast stitching portion there. We've got two position memory for the rear seats, massage, rear seat heating, your own independent climate control. And then this one has the Rolls-Royce bespoke audio system with these beautiful metal speaker grates. To step in, there's a ridge behind each seat to gently guide yourself in. And this seat is slid a bit further forward than my seating position at 6 feet tall, but we can see I've got plenty of leg room. There are big map pockets and there are lamb's wool carpets. Don't worry, I'll clean those later. And furthermore, those carpets will raise up into footrests when you press on these buttons here. And it's gotta be a blood flow thing because having your feet at an angle like this actually reduces your thigh support, yet somehow I'm even more relaxed. And here I've got my Rolls-Royce pillows. I've got tons of headroom, which gets the thumbs up for me, under this leather-lined starlight headliner with itty-bitty LEDs. There is a giant vanity mirror that comes down, hello, along with another one here by my right shoulder to presumably dust them off. There's a trolley car style grab handle that comes down, which is soothing to operate. And we've got buttons to close up our doors. This Phantom has dark amber wood veneer covering the deploying picnic tables. To use the screens in the back of the seat, you gotta pop open this veneer to access your Spirit of Ecstasy dial. And that's the only way to control these screens. They're not touch screens. Here we've got your seat settings, and under this leather-topped console, we find a little bit of storage along with a DC outlet. No USBs back here, not even down here. That's just another DC. We do have a disc insert and there are real metal air vents with these fun plungers. This Phantom also has the optional champagne refrigerator with two different cooling settings, one for new champagne and one for aged champagne. It also has storage for your crystal flutes. And if you insist on having another passenger with you, you can lift up the console for a middle seat. Before we hear from the door close noise, let's check out the Rolls-Royce umbrellas that deploy from within the door. And we know the doors can close themselves, but let's overwrite that to hear the very satisfying solid thud. In the front seats, perforated leather like the back, with heating and massage, more Pelony pink accenting there, and on the headrest, more lambswool carpets with leather padded pillows for the driver to rest his or her foot on when operating the aluminum accented foot pedals. There are aluminum tread plates with Phantom spelled out, these three chrome strakes now on the front doors, unlike the back. There's a joystick to control your power adjusting and power folding door mirrors, two position memory for the driver and passenger front seat. We can press down here to open the power operated tailgate, or trunk lid rather, keep thinking it's an SUV, it's so big, to find 19 cubic feet of space, and it's fully carpeted, just in case you want to hang out back here. Power close and lock feature is on that trunk lid. And as we move to the driver's seat, there are controls to power close those doors. There are only two notable changes to the interior of the Phantom 423. One, they slightly thickened the rim of this leather-wrapped and heated steering wheel, and two, they now 3D print the interior of that bespoke analog clock, which is separated from us by this glass partition, which means that this is not a touchscreen. You have to control it with this dial down here, and it does have wireless Apple CarPlay and Android Auto. To the right of the screen is what Rolls-Royce calls the gallery, and this one has the regatta sails, or layered leather. There's more amberwood veneer here on the dash, you've got a physical volume knob, media settings, HVAC controls, and then under these veneers, a slot for your key, and cup holders. Under this leather-topped console is a decent bit of storage, also leather-lined, of course, with a wireless smartphone charging slot, DC outlet, and USB-A port. Visibility is kind of just okay because those back pillars are pretty thick. Thankfully, there's standard blind spot monitoring with rear cross traffic. This cabin is extravagant with all the rich materials. The traditional luxuries crush in here. The technology, not so much. Now let's take the new Phantom for a drive.
All right, let's fire it up. Would you ever in a million years think that I had just started a 12-cylinder? Like really, the front end barely wiggled, and now we're idling quieter than a 4-cylinder. The insulation in this car is another level. Drive mode, not really a thing. We do have this low button here on the stock, and that's like the sporty setting for this car, calibrating the throttle response and shift timing in a more eager fashion, but that's it. Reverse in and up on the stock, that brings up a high resolution camera. We got the bird's eye view off to the left and the backup with trajectory lines off to the right. And we can also scan around the exterior, which is not in the same Iguazu blue as our vehicle. I wonder why. And let's back on up. The door locks are louder than the engine. Down to drive. Let's begin with the world famous horn test. Oh. That horn sounds expensive. It's the fanciest horn I've ever heard in my life. Turn signal sound. That's just run-of-the-mill BMW stuff. Not distinctive. Not like this powertrain. 6¾ liter. Feel like it has to be said that way. Twin turbocharged V12. It makes 563 horsepower and 664 pound-feet of torque. That is routed through all four tires, through an 8-speed automatic gearbox. And though that really is a mountain of power and torque, it's only ever really what Rolls-Royce has historically called sufficient output. It's sufficient for getting up to speed, it's sufficient for making a pass. And you feel that because of all of the travel of the accelerator pedal. between here and the end of the pedal, just, it feels like the hood looks, which is just endless. And so then in normal mode, nothing's ever really abrupt. You get up to speed. You've got enough power to get up to speed. And more on that hood for a second. I think it looks so long because it's so upright, whereas I was just in the Mercedes-AMG SL, and that was a very long hood, but it went down and away from your line of visibility. This is just forever you looking at your spirit of ecstasy and knowing that you made it in life. The seats I could write poetry about. Absurdly thick and plush, supportive in all the right places. The brake pedal tuning is just like the throttle. You've got a ton of travel to just ease you down to speed. The turning radius is remarkable given the immenseness of this sedan. The rear wheel steering helping to pivot the car and make maneuvering this giant thing so easy. Ride quality in a Phantom is pure bliss. There are only one or two times where you will go over a bump that is so abrupt, so harsh, a pothole, that you will be awoken from your spell of tranquility to the fact that you are, in fact, driving something, and you did just go over something serious. Otherwise, you just waft and relax. We should see how quick the Phantom will get to 60, though, shouldn't we? Let's do a real-world 0-60 test next. For that, I've got my race box set up over here because the front glass is so obscenely thick, wasn't getting a single signal. Going into low now. There's, of course, no launch control. I'm just going to do a bit of a brake boost as we get off the line. And there's 60 in 5.1 seconds, which is as fast as you should ever need to go in the Phantom. But we could feel off the line a big surge, swell of power. Yet, all I felt was more comfortable because I'm just getting squished back further into these obscenely plush chairs. I'm obliged to return to the way that the Phantom moves down the road, and particularly the way that the steering operates. Now, I mentioned in the interior walk around that they had thickened the rim of the wheel ever so slightly for 23. And I can't say that was the best decision because I loved how delicate the rim of the wheel was. I felt like it went with the way that you operate the car, which is just carefully, in very small measure. The steering in the Phantom is shockingly similar to a Jeep Wrangler, in that both wheel diameters are huge, and whereas in the Wrangler you want little inputs to create little effects on the tires so that you can make your way up obstacles, in the Phantom you just want little inputs because you don't want the vehicle to rock too heavily one side or the other because your movement was too abrupt. And so you can just delicately direct this car with a single finger. And everyone just sort of oozes left or right in their seat. Everything about how the Phantom drives is really just like an ace for a chauffeur. Slowly, gracefully. It just makes your occupants happy and chill all the time. Even if your client is in a hurry. So let's go back to low. I'm racing the G-Class. propelling up this hill. It's so easy. But you could never tell. I mean, apart from looking at the speedometer, you couldn't tell how fast you're going because it stays. So mellow in this cabin. Okay, you hear a little of that V12, and it is a good note, by the way. But that's about it. You just go. And no, there is no manual mode in the Phantom. And no, you don't need it. It wouldn't make sense in this car, where the goal is ultimate zen. And to that end, there is no quieter car you can buy. It stifles all external disruption. So whatever tension you bring to your drive melts away, and you just say, even when someone cuts you off, even if you lost $1 million in the stock market today, nothing really seems capable of getting you that upset. You've got many millions of dollars more. Who cares? You're gonna get there eventually. Who cares if someone cuts you off? You can't really exit this state of, and I'm going to use the miles per hour word of the day, serenity. You can't be anything less than untroubled. You can't be anything more than peaceful. You don't really have a choice. Just sit back and enjoy it. And purely for curiosity's sake, we are going to do a braking and handling test in the Phantom. So I'll go back to low, I'm not really sure why, as we carry a bit of speed into this curve. Hard on the brakes. Interesting. Leaning heavy and feeling nothing from the steering, but remaining as always composed. I think I was most impressed with that braking. Given how little initial bite you feel from the brakes around town, I was expecting a long, long stop and no pedal feel. And I got a reasonable stop, given the 5,700 pounds of weight here, and something in terms of resistance from that pedal. And then the turn in was slow, and the steering was dead, but the car remained settled as we took that curve at speed. So in emergency situations, nothing more will you ever take the Phantom for a Canyon Drive, for example, but in emergency situations, you can count on this car to stay reasonably in check. There is no super sophisticated driving assistance system in the Phantom. We do have adaptive cruise control and a lane departure warning system that'll vibrate the steering wheel if you depart that lane. But the latest and greatest in terms of adaptive cruise and steering assistance, even that you find in BMW products, which again, BMW owns Rolls-Royce, are not here. And I think the idea is, and I'm sure they cross-shop this, or rather focus group this one, the idea is that you should be not distracted behind the wheel of the Phantom. But you'd think that those systems, as good as they've become, would relax you even more. So I'm kind of surprised that they're not here. But also not here is noise at highway speed. There's nary more than a brush of wind noise at the windshield and here in the side glass. The tires, these 22-inch wheels, make the faintest hum. And passing traffic might as well not be there. Now, before we get into pricing and competition, let's go over the top speed and the fuel economy of the Phantom. Top speed is limited to 155 miles per hour, and the fuel economy is terrible. It's 12 mpg city, 18 highway, and 14 combined. The starting figure for the Phantom is a, get ready, $483,000 proposition, and this one as tested is $628,000. Competitors, there's a big step down in price. We've got the Bentley Flying Spur W12 that starts at $219,000. It makes 626 horsepower and it gets to 60 in just 3.8 seconds. We also have the Mercedes Maybach S650. That one starts at $203,000. It makes 621 horsepower and it gets to 60 in 4.6 seconds, similar to the Phantom. If you have gobs of cash, let's be clear, nothing is going to be as smooth riding, as quiet, or make as big of a statement as the Phantom. However, if you really enjoy driving, like the feedback and the performance, while also having intense luxury, then the Bentley Flying Spur W12 is going to be your car. And if you are exclusively going to be chauffeured, then even though they make a long wheelbase version of the Phantom, the Mercedes Maybach S650 has immense amounts of legroom. It has the latest and greatest technology and conveniences for rear occupants. That's probably the way you'll want to go. I also need to say one other thing, just to kind of frame this car, because people who aspire to one day own these extremely high-end luxury vehicles may only ever, even if they play their cards very, very right, may only ever get to the Mercedes-Benz S-Class level, kind of $100,000 to spend on a luxury vehicle. And they're sitting there wondering, how big is the gap between an S-Class and a Rolls-Royce Phantom? Put it in these terms. The gap between a $30,000 Toyota Camry and a $100,000 Mercedes-Benz S-Class is cavernous in terms of the refinement level. The gap between an S-Class and a Phantom is not nearly as large. But if you drive the two cars back to back, you will notice the difference. And when you have boatloads of money, more than you know what to do with, you will not be satisfied with an S-Class or even with a Bentley Flying Spur or even with the Maybach. You'll only be satisfied with this car. If you had the money though, which would you choose? Would you go Maybach? Would you go Flying Spur? Would you get the Phantom? Let me know in the comments. I'm very, very curious. And I hope you guys have enjoyed this POV drive review. If you did, please like, comment, and share the video. Subscribe to the channel. Hit that bell to get notified. And once more into low, I'll see you again next time.